but at the end of the day, what actually we mean by, at least I mean, independent quantum mechanics is nothing but Schrodinger equation, right? Schrodinger equation solves all this. I told you guys to come in front, what nonsense? You come. Those who are hiding back, you. Yeah. Now, what we're talking is Schrodinger equation. So, Schrodinger equation, so, it's really interesting. You know the story, how quantum mechanics came? Anybody knows the story? I discovered it by accident. Huh? No, I'm saying story, real story, not science. So what happened, I found it because in Poly Street, we had a book I picked up by 1.5 rupees. That or 2 maybe, I don't know. But this has all the papers of Schrodinger. There are 5 papers. Did it occur to you, this I tell everybody, that in the entire first part of quantum mechanics, there is no other name? It's amazing. There's no other name. You do particle in a box, you do rigid rotator, you do harmonic oscillator, you do hydrogen atom, you do hydrogen molecule. All these are not a single name anymore. That because everything was done by Schrodinger. Okay. So when de Broglie came with wave particle duality, then there's a meeting and there's a lot of excitement. And wave particle duality paper, he was in army. He came back, he was 24 years old, de Broglie. He wrote this paper for his PhD thesis. And the it was sent to Lord Rutherford. Rutherford said, I could not make head or tail of this. But there is one man who can understand it, who can, if it is right or wrong, to send it to Einstein. Einstein immediately realized that it's a great breakthrough. But they had a meeting. After that, there was a lot of excitement. And in the meeting, Peter Debye made the comment that it is silly of talking of a wave without a wave equation. Okay, so Schrodinger was 38 years old. He has already accomplished quite a bit in thermodynamics. He has a beautiful book on thermodynamics and other things. But he realized the great chance he had. So he took off, took leave, and by that time Heisenberg has done his formulation of quantum mechanics in terms of matrices. People, it was working, because what you need, Heisenberg's A was that, Heisenberg's contention was that you should only have observables in your theory. And what are the observables? Those are the transition matrices, right? They are the absorption processes, like Mama series. So we need to build a theory of that, and if we build the theory, huge amount of experimental data available. I can go into Heisenberg, but I should rather come back. So now, people didn't like Heisenberg formulation. It was working, and all these things. You have to understand, Heisenberg formulation of quantum mechanics is wonderful. Operator based, but is different from his uncertainty principle. Those are two different things. So Schrodinger went and then went to took a leave of 3 months and he finished everything. He actually derived first the relativistic quantum mechanics, which later became Klein-Gordon equation. That I could not explain hydrogen molecule because of an accidental degeneracy he didn't know of. So he did the time-independent, non-relativistic quantum mechanics. He also did time-dependent quantum mechanics, everything. And he did it essentially, there's a first edition of Berry, Rice and Ross that has the derivation which I got from that book, which still there, collected works of Schrodinger. Wonderful, for 1.5 rupees, it's not bad. Now, so Schrodinger equation came first, postulates came later. So that's the way actually it happened. Construction of a theoretical framework is very rather interesting. Itself is a study of history of science. So this is a bit of history of science of quantum mechanics. Now we'll do, you must know the background. If you don't know the background, you won't be able to understand. And because you won't feel, and to feel for it is very important. Now postulates of statistical mechanics is a little bit more structured in the evolution. The reason was that it took a much longer time. It started essentially with Maxwell and went on for done by Wheeler Gibbs. So it was almost 50 years or 40 years, starting say somewhere in mid 15s, and it went on to 1903 or 1905, around that time. Amazing, Wheeler Gibbs didn't get a Nobel Prize or anything, but he was still alive. Now, how did it start? I told you already, Maxwell had this distribution, which Boltzmann tried to explain and extend in terms of intermolecular interactions, and he got lost on the way because it was too complicated. But Boltzmann and Maxwell did introduce the concept of the probability. Maxwell in terms of our distribution of velocity, which you know, Maxwell distribution. And Boltzmann tried to do a good job on that time-dependent distribution. So he write, what is the probability of that things like he wanted a probability distribution, he called it F R V T, that particle is at position R with volume V. So if I have a box and there are a bunch of particles, let me look at this particle. And now he wanted to know what is the probability of the particle being in position R, this is a position R, with the velocity V at time T. When he tried to do that, he wanted to calculate these things. We go as classical mechanics tensors, we take a time derivative. What makes it change? What makes it change then goes into a collision with another particle. Okay, that mean involves F2 R1 V1 R2 V2. And if I want to do two particles, then I have three particles. This is a very important example called hierarchy. That means one particle, to get one particle distribution, I need two particle distribution. And two particle, I need three particle distribution. And these are very formidable things. Time dependent distribution of position, velocity, highly difficult things. You know, if you think of Newton's equation, you have to solve the Newton's equations in a three-dimensional space of all these particles, which is just not doable, even today, very difficult to compute even with all these things. So that was the problem that Boltzmann faced. Even though he was doing a probabilistic description, even then it was difficult, that he made an approximation that he decomposed F2 into F1 and F1, and that is called molecular chaos, and that hell got loose and was heavily criticized. Okay. As I told a couple of times before, and I'll probably tell a few more times, that Wheeler Gibbs from the other side of the Atlantic was observing this. And he was, of course, a brilliant man. And he realized that I might be saying things as they come to my mind, so they might not be completely placed in right sequence. But as I tell you, I'll get the sequence right and I might repeat it. So these, as I'm thinking, I'm talking, and these things fall in place. Now, Wheeler Gibbs realized one thing, and that's very important. He realized that, okay, if you have to solve all these equations of motions and these kind of things, and ultimately they are all boiled down to Newton's equation, which is not possible, then how do I go about it? Then one thing he realized that, look, if I'm doing some equilibrium properties, like as I told you, a glass of water sitting on my table, that equilibrium properties is density, specific heat, it's compressibility or other properties, that I don't need to, because all the, I have 100 glasses of water, all of them behave same way. Doesn't look like dynamics is important for them. So there must be a way to talk of them, to describe these things. And but doing that requires certain amount of basic framework of understanding, and that's what we are going to do first. Introduce some very fundamental concepts which some of you might know, those who have studied classical mechanics, something I very strongly recommend. And the classical mechanics, I remember I studied classical mechanics, one of the reasons I studied, I was in a PG hall, where one room, small room, there are four people in that room, some of four beds could be packed in, and there are two of them are physicists, and they are all the time studying classical mechanics, and would study great classical mechanics. So it was really, really fortunate that I started studying that when I was still a student in Calcutta. But it's amazing, that book and a book by V.I. Arnold, Classical Mechanics, name, same title. I tell you, recommend few pages in front, you should read. Okay. So what we are going to talk today, and there are some of them are not properly does, they are too much talking, and they are from the book that I wrote. This is something I told, is highly non-trivial, you cannot do that. Okay. Now, first I define what the phase space. Phase space, I already have it here. If I have a single particle, yeah, I want to describe on a single particle, yeah, might be other particles, but I just want to on one single particle, and I want to plot its position against its momentum. Now, in physicist way, momentum comes as x-axis, and position usually q, but I'll continue with r. And then, this particle is moving, so it will be exchange momentum, but I am only looking at that. So it goes like that, moving here, a unbound point. This six-dimensional space, which is a position and momentum, is called the phase space of the particle. So it is a mu, single particle phase space is a mu space. Mu for molecule, essentially, single particle. So if I have the mu space, now, consider the six-dimensional space, and a six-dimensional space, I give a point. So a point in six-dimensional space is the instantaneous state of the particle. It's very important. Instantaneous state of the particle is given by point. And as the particle moves, it draws, it portrays a trajectory. So this is the phase space. And the motion of the particle in the six dimensions mu space is called the trajectory. These are very important things, phase space and the trajectory. However, we are interested in many body system, a jargon we'll use several times, means n particles are there. Now, I want to become a little bit more ambitious. I want to consider, let us consider for simplicity, but without compromising much of the rigor, that n atoms are gone. They are interacting as any other atoms and molecules do, but they don't have the complications of rotation. These n particles, I want to describe them together. Then I write down another phase space that would be okay. Now, this is a 6n dimensional space. The 6n dimensional space is called gamma space. Then one point in the 6n dimensional space gives me the instantaneous state of the entire system. Because it has in this, so it's a vector, it has 6n numbers, like a three-dimensional space, a vector has 3 numbers, right? There is 6n numbers. These numbers together, so it's a vector, you can consider it's a column vector. So that vector, the values in that vector gives you the instantaneous state of the entire system. Now I can draw a, now as the system, now entire system moving, like you can consider one of you, I describe position and your velocity, that will be the mu space, but all of you together, I want to describe, that is the comma space, okay, that is the entire phase space of the phase space of the entire system, and the movement of the particle in that entire system, movement of this point in that gamma space is the trajectory of the entire system. So these are the concepts of phase space and trajectory.
Sir,
yeah.
Sir, are we plotting x as a function of p?
No, they're independent. God bless you. No, God not bless you, I don't know. But no, they are independent.
So how then? How can we like draw this graph?
Of course, you can do go to Newton's equation. You have a v dot mv dot equal to acceleration. And what is acceleration? Force. And what is force? Derivative of potential. It's a good question. Okay, good that you asked, then I can explain a little bit more of what I will preempt, what is make it easy for me. So Newton's, let write the great man's name. Four first two equations were done by whom? Not by Newton. Who? The first two equations. Louder. Galileo. Newton formulated the whole thing very cogently, but it was done by Galileo. Okay. So mv dot mass, this acceleration equals to force. Okay. Force on one particle. This means ith particle. Mass is same, all of them. Then it is the position ri, force on ith particle. Okay? Then minus I take derivative of v. Here is the potential of, however, depends on all the n particles because of interaction. Okay. That means my this particle here interacting with all others. Well, I don't need to take all of them, but I'll need to take the nearest neighbor. For the sake of generality, I have put the n particles here. So now I give you initial position and particle. Position and momentum are always independent. In Newton's equation. They are talking with each other through Newton's equation, but they are completely independent. Okay? There are many ways. That's why if you take a multiply x with v and take an average, average will come today. We will discuss. Then you get to zero. That means they are uncorrelated. So I want all of you, now that we are on Newton, to understand that this n particle system, each particle is evolving according to Newton's equation. I give you initial position and velocity, momentum at time t equal to 0. Then I can solve Newton's equation from that. And I can find the position and momentum of an attack particle or any particle at a little later time. Okay. So I can now go from, this is my gamma space. I can go the iteration over all n particles, then I find at a little later time, this is my position. Then another little time, this is my position. Then it might be this is my position, this is my position. Then what I have, this, I draw the line, this is my trajectory. Okay, it's very important that you understand trajectory. Because I'm next going to talk about averages, and averages are over the trajectory. In the real world, all our averages are time averages. When you say average salary of a person, there are two things. Individual salary is a time averaging, okay? But of course, you can average over all other substance. That we'll call ensemble average. We'll come to that. So it's a good question. At the end of the day, I was a little taken aback, but okay. Now, we explained phase space. We explained territory. It's a very, very interesting concept that you describe the entire state of the system by a point in the 6n-dimensional gamma space. Okay. Now, in the case of phase space, I want you to solve a few simple problems to get a hang of P and Q, and that is done here. So these are directly from my book, and this is what I just told you. And then this is the location, is given a point, terms are representative point, and this representative point, the repetition sequence of positions as I draw here is called a territory. Done well. I didn't know I wrote quite well. Of course, I have been corrected by many people. So now I want you to do, now let us look at the trajectory of a harmonic oscillator. Now harmonic oscillator, what is a harmonic oscillator, what it is called? Difference between harmonic oscillator and free particle, what is that? Free particle is free, it can all over this space. And a harmonic oscillator is a bound state. If it is bound state, and remember energy is conserved. That's the our background of Newton's equation. But Newton's equation was not too much used in analytical work because energy conservation gives you a great advantage. That advantage is not in Newton's description. That is in Hamiltonian description. Have you read Hamiltonian equations of motion? Hamilton's equations? You should read Hamilton's equation. That is a very beautiful. Pi dot is dh dqi, dqi dot minus dh dpi. You get momentum identical, the same as Newton's equation, but it's in terms of Hamiltonian. Actually, quantum mechanics was formulated from the Hamiltonian dynamics. It was not from Newton's equation. Okay. Then we found the other way that you put P equal to d dx and the Newton's equation. Schrodinger equation, time independent equation is just nothing but a statement of the conservation of energy. Okay, these are all, if you make the connection, it's very nice. Okay, so in this harmonic oscillator, this bound state, it will be a sphere, ellipse, and the body will be closed curve. That you have to do it. The computer, sit down, start taking a frequency, and do the Newton's equation, and find out, who will give this problem? Give omega equal to maybe 10 to the power 13 second inverse, and give a range of x, and give h, let them solve in computer, and generate this graph. Okay. Now, this is a mu space, one single particle. Okay, how many oscillator? Free particle will be like that. It will be covering a whole space. And there will be some liquid molecules here, they are all going into this free particle is here, and of two tagged molecules, they are moving around, particle 1 and particle 2. And so, they might be interacting, they are crossing path here, okay. And but this would be like that in the phase space. If I want to look into only two particles, then I will have a 12-dimensional space. And if you don't talk on momentum, sometimes you won't need to talk on momentum, we'll see, then it's a 6-dimensional. So this is the examples of trajectory that you need to know. Now, there are from trajectory, you can say a lot of very interesting things. We just say harmonic oscillator. But also, harmonic oscillator will be located in one position. If I look at the configuration space, but that means in X space, the position space. But many times in chemical kinetics, I really did not do a proper justice to chemical kinetics when I talked of preliminaries. I should have done, because that's one of the major things that we chemists are interested. and one of the major things that we do in statistical mechanics. Okay. We just did a work on protein dissociation, insulin dimer dissociation, very important biological process in control of sugar in body and diabetes. And statistical mechanics is the only way you can do that. That's what the power of statistical mechanics. I'm not talking about work, but I'm talking about the example. However, let's say that we have a chemical reaction going on, and this is one step. Systems isomerization of stilbene. You know stilbene, all of you know stilbene. Okay, so that is from cis to trans. I just say both of them are equivalent, they need not be equivalent, but this doesn't matter. So then I'm going over that. Then that is a trajectory of that process. And then it goes over. When it goes there, it doesn't spend too much time there because that's high energy position. So it just goes over there. So this is an example of a trajectory of a chemical reaction. Okay. That's the way we describe chemical reaction. And it's a huge area of research. Many, many Nobel Prize came to this area because of the importance of this, starting with the most recent, many in the past, in recent times, you know the name of Manfred Reigen, Norris and Porter, then Dardy Hersberg, Yang Lee, then Yang Taube, then Rudy Marcus, then Armin Zuel, name goes on and on. And more recently, 4 years ago, what's his name? Martin Karplas and that group got for enzyme kinetics. Okay. So this I just telling all these things to tell you the kind of importance we give to this thing. So this is a chemical kinetics and the trend. Now I now going to be very important. You can read it, but it doesn't matter because what I'm going to now describe, which is one of the important things in the course. Okay. I'm deliberately going a little slow. I can go very fast, but I don't want to do that because of the importance of this area. So, as I explained in response to Atondrito's question that we have to solve Newton's equation. And I also told you, we cannot solve Newton's equation, even for a two-particle system. Other than harmonic oscillators and these things, but two particle unbound system interacting, even with the Reynolds goes, we still can potentially kind of solve the question other than a quadrature. Two particles over oscillators. So poor Boltzmann tried to do it, and then he realized, I think I already told you, that equilibrium statistical mechanics does not really require great, you know, it doesn't seem reasonable that if I want to describe an equilibrium liquid. You know, in this happened before StatMech. So in StatMech, you have a very clear distinction between equilibrium statistical mechanics and time-dependent statistical mechanics. So when you want to describe transition from one state to another state, you need the time-dependent statistical mechanics. But you are just describing energy levels of a particle in a box or a harmonic oscillator, iterator, you don't need time-dependent statistical mechanics. You can do it with time-independent statistical mechanics. So Boltzmann approach analogously was for time-dependent statistical mechanics. The equation he derived played a very important role later, that is called Boltzmann kinetic equation. So then quantum mechanics was far, you know, because Gibbs was doing in 1901, 1902 at that time. So what he realized that what we measure experimentally, what he was trying to do, was Boltzmann was trying to do is a quantity when I'm defining an average. Now I have taken an example of average, the temperature of the system. The temperature of the system we all know is 3/mv². Now, but this is an average. Remember, that's what you do. You do an average over a distribution in Maxwell's calculation of these things, and that is e^-mv² / cavity, Gaussian distribution. However, how do I calculate the average? This is the following way. I follow the trajectory of a particle over a long time, and I do, the one that I need is v squared and v square is, then I integrate over ds. For which, for integrate means I'm just taking an average. Remember, one name, another name of integration is averaging. And I do 0 to t, and I end up 1 over t, and I do for a very long time, limit t going to infinity. This is my v square. I can do a better job by giving over all the n particles, but that's not needed. This is enough. Yeah, 1 over t, this is enough. Limit t going to infinity is the important thing. Okay. Many times you do the both the thing to make it average a little better. But this is the concept. The concept of average directed is called the time averaging. Very important. Now let us consider a much bigger property of the system, like what we call X, general property, density, specific heat, compressibility, or many other things. Then I want to calculate this average property. Sorry, this time independent. So, because I have integrated down. Okay, is that okay? I now make a change of notation. I don't want to call it by angular brackets. I want to call it by bar. If it is slow, then you should have taken a lot of mathematics courses. Really interesting. They on one equation and one page, they spend the entire class. I heard many talks of mathematicians. They use two slides. One slide, the title of the talk, second slide is one slide. Because they are very, very careful not to make mistakes and be very thorough. Okay. So this is my bar. Now I make it into. All right. This is my time energy.
Shouldn't the T be inside the limit?
Yeah. Correct. Sorry. Thank you. Okay. Now, is it clear now? What is the time averaging? So, time averaging means, say, you want to know the average speed of a person walking, you follow him for a long time, his walking speed, you can put one of those sticks, what do they call? And you can measure the speed. That's what it does actually. Your heartbeat, it gives average heartbeat. Everything is just time average. So most of the things, all the machines do have the time average. The stupid Google is time averaging how many times you are clicking on one thing and adding it together. God, what life we are leading. Now, you suggest what movie I should see. This is so bad. Now, so this is the time averaging. Now, we are talking on equilibrium property. Now let us again say in my, I go back to my gamma space, my n particle phase space. Now let us imagine what is happening in this six n dimensional space. My system is all the particles and molecules and atoms are moving. They are translating, they are rotating, they are colliding, but they are moving in the gamma space. So I am seeing in real world what I am following. I cannot see it, but what is happening is the evolution of the system, time evolution of the system. System is going through many, many microscopic states. Very important. And each microscopic state is given by the position and momentum of my n particles. Okay. So they are all changing. So the property that I see is a consequence of my averaging over this n particle system. Motion of the n particle system, n particles in the six n dimensional space. That's what I see when I say density of a particle in an open system. That's what I see when I talk of specific. I already said there are fluctuations. That's what I see, average of those fluctuations. Okay. So now, this is the time averaging. Now, what brilliant idea of Wheeler Gibbs was that, okay, as the microscope, what I am doing for a very long time, I am seeing the system evolving through the, whenever I start saying that, this Big Bang theory of Sheldon to Penny in a warm summer evening in Greece. You know, if you have not seen the Big Bang, that particular episode you should really see. It's an amazing one. And the one where he goes to jail by telling the judge that the judge is stupid. Now, so when the particles are moving, the system is moving through the gamma space. Now, Wheeler Gibbs thought, okay, if my system is an equilibrium, and I'm going through this gamma space, then can't I replace it by a process where instead of the trajectory, I can think, I can take snapshots, and I can think that a mental replica of one system and mental replica of my of all these things which are having different positions and momentum. So each system is a different microscopic state, and there are billions and billions and trillions of microscopes, huge number, 10 to the 30, 40 microscopic states of a system. So, but if I can now see that my system is, I can construct a, those trillion examples, replicas, all of them have the same microscopic property, same thermodynamic property, same constitution, same number of particles, but in different positions of their along the phase space. If I can my mental replica of them, then I don't have to solve the Newton's equation. But I need to then go back to Maxwell and can talk of a distribution. Okay. So this mental replica of trillions and trillions of mental replica are called the ensembles. This was a wonderful, you know, I think one of the most brilliant idea of mankind ever has come is the concept of the ensemble and the replacement. So now, what Gibbs said that, okay, if I can construct an ensemble, and he demonstrated, of course, that because it worked out 100% correctly, that if we can have these ensembles, then if I know the microscopic states, time average is nothing but the ensemble average. Of course, I don't know how to do it yet, but I can think about that. Okay, so that there came the idea of the ensemble, and that go into the partition function and those kind of things. So, so rationale behind these postulates is that that experimental observable can be defined as an average or time trajectory of the property, and this is very now comes the. So one postulate of statistical mechanics, postulate number one, that my time ensemble average equal to time average. So I explained to you the rationale behind the entire thing. So now I tell my x is limit infinity 1 over t to t. X is the property of one system, and that system is evolving in gamma space, and I am going along its trajectory. And I am my time trajectory. So time is flowing like that. This is time, and I am sitting on that time, and I am doing Newton's calculation. We're going from one state to another state, and once I get the time, whole position and momentum, I calculate the property, thermodynamic property that I want. That I know how to do, provided I give me time and position. Of course, even after getting there, there's a lot of work. So this is a time trajectory. Now the ensemble average is different. Ensemble average is property x in ith ensemble. This is the okay, I think I should get a little bit different notation because n I am using for number of particles. So let me, what will all be my nice n. So instead of one water, glass of water molecules, where you follow the motion of every water molecule for a very long time, I create trillions of glasses. And why this could work? It could work because number of microscopic states is trillions of trillions of trillions. So my possibility of repeating, getting my system of an ensemble in the same microscopic thing is negative. So there is a very strong thing that gives understood even those days. So the first postulate of statistical mechanics is then, I still miss my chalk and blackboard, though dusty. Time average for 1 second. This is the first question. Okay. Time average for 1 second. The definitions are given here. Okay? All right. Now, the first postulate now gives the ended in a trouble. Because we made this, but now we have to make sure that the ensembles, he has no way of controlling the microscopic states of the system. And the microscope, the system inhabits at any given time or in his ensemble, any given member of the ensemble, any given member of the ensemble is occupying a microscopic state. Okay, that is time independent. You got it for once, that's it, t equal to zero, nothing else, it's not evolving. It is evolving, but you don't care, you don't need that. You are going to average over only time independent averaging, like in equilibrium statement, time independent averaging over many ensembles, they are microscopic states. But he landed in trouble now. Landed in trouble because he has he has to do an averaging and he need a power distribution. He has no power distribution. Then he chose to work on a system which is called microcanonical, called NVE, constant number, constant volume, and constant energy. Each member of the ensemble has the same number of particles, same volume, same constant energy surface. Then he made the assumption, second postulate of statistical mechanics, equal a priori probability. All these ensembles, all these states are equally probable. And that's another brilliant. So second postulate, dark brown, that was a very nice color. So,
second postulate on SM
is that little important what comes first, ensemble average. Okay. You understand what is done? What is the motivation? Motivation was to avoid calculating trajectory. Motivation was that for equilibrium properties, we don't need to do so much horrendous work. Partly meaningless, and fortunately we are not doable. Because we are correlated. Much happened in science many times. So, ensemble average equal to time average. Time average is the one you want. Time average is the experimental thing. But we kind of just like exactly starting with time average, starting equation, starting with kind of a step out by step or avoid it. Same thing one is done through these things. And as I told you again, we do mention on this matter, physics and chemistry. Okay. Now, having done that, now A landed in one more trouble with Gibbs. What is the trouble that Gibbs now faced? He has put his created ensembles, mental construction of the system. He has put time average, ensemble average equal to time average. Second postulate is equally probability, right? Why did I write that? I was thinking already of third thing. So this is equally probability. Sorry. You should have told me that. What of you? I think mumbling. Oh, equally probable. That's the thought. Now he landed in trouble. What is the trouble that now Gibbs landed? Anybody can guess? Of course, you know, very difficult to guess.
Sir, how to give all the negative super probability are possible?
Yeah, related to that. Okay, second postulate is that we have huge number of microscopic states. My system inhabits them in ensemble. Ensemble is that. And then I need in order to calculate properties, I need a probability distribution. I go to NVE ensemble, which is called microcanonical ensemble. We continue first part of the work with that. Then everything is a constant energy surface, constant number, constant volume. I have no information to go on it. They are constant energy. He had Boltzmann energy distribution already in mind. So he made the assumption, far-reaching assumption, that all microscopic states are equal. So it's a flat. So I can now average. I can write a property and just add them up because I don't have a prefactor, I don't have probability. Okay. So equal probability is a wonderful. That people of course knew it in classical mechanics a little bit already, but it's so wonderful. Now having made second one, something very clear to close to what you said, correctly, what's your name? Orko or Orka? Why people call Orko Orka, I never know. I had one of my very good friend's son. I used to call him Orko, but they were corrected in Orka. Okay. Now, why? That guy, you don't love, that guy going to become the ambassador, this very famous guy of Canada in Vietnam, and doing a lot of very nice work. Now, Orko, what Orko said correctly, that we need to now make sure that, now I have secured my ensemble. When I have created the trillions and trillions of ensembles all in different distinct microscopic states. But now I have to make sure my initial thing, my time averaging, that my system is going through all these microscopic states. See, I can put them in different microscopic states. Nothing's hold me from that. But there are many cases where liquids are very slow, like in glass and crystal. Now I have to make sure my system, the time trajectory, goes through that. That it must visit all microscopic states. So then come, these two are connected, first and second postulate, were connected by a hypothesis which is called arbitrary hypothesis. That that has is the whole entire discipline of mathematics, algorithmic hypothesis. This is unfortunately not a single book other than great Richard Tolman in 1940s does a good job what I'm telling you here. So these two are connected. Goes from here and goes there on. I should be aware of it. Good. Okay. Now, so ergodic hypothesis is the hypothesis that tells the system visits all states with equal problems. Which means if I, in my mental construction, if I think of it for a very long time, then equal number of times, each microscope, if I take time going to infinity much larger than number of states, then system visits all states with equal probability. That's the problem. So that makes sure that my ensemble approach is correct. You see, there was otherwise, there was a gap. Gap is that I, in the ensemble, I have to take mental construction and put them all in different microscopic states. But again, these things breaks down in the in air glass transition, where the viscosity goes to 10 to 10 Poisson. Then system does, in experimental measurement, the system does not go to all the microscopic states. So then we can still do thermodynamic averaging. I can do ensemble averaging. But I find my ensemble averaging doesn't agree with the experiment. Because the experiment is doing time averaging. Okay. So the ergodic hypothesis then puts these, makes sure that my two postulates work. So that's why two postulates are connected by the ergodic hypothesis. There's nothing mysterious here. These are all beautiful and held together. Now let me tell you that people had a very long time, there was a famous exchange between one very great guy called Uhlenbeck, I think, who discovered spin of electron and got a Nobel Prize, right? Now, Stern and Uhlenbeck. Uhlenbeck was one of the, he has beautiful books on statistical mechanics and probability theory. And there was a guy at that time, his name was Jennings. Jennings was developing an alternate approach to statistical mechanics, which is also very nice. The effort kind of fizzled out. It has its contribution on information entropy. And he was saying entropy can be defined from the information, like Heisenberg. And he wanted to, so he wrote to Uhlenbeck, saying that, look, you have a limitation in the stat man because you cannot do phase transition on these things. Fortunately for us and Uhlenbeck, right that year 1952, 232 thesis, C. N. Young Diddley, who also got the Nobel Prize, they proved that within the statistical mechanics, how to describe the phase transition. Uhlenbeck answered to Jennings that then. The paper came out in 52 and this corresponds to 52 or 53. But no, we don't have any more problems as we can achieve this paper year and year and year. Okay. So that is where the A is, the rationale of. And so you can read my book where these this flow of logic. Going from first postulate to second postulate and to ergodic hypothesis and the need for doing that. I think I didn't do a too bad a job, but I usually shy away or dislike reading my own writing. Because I always think I find a mistake. But I think I did a good job, better than any other book. That's it, why we stop here. So I did phase space, what I did today, I did phase space and trajectory. explained to you, I explained to you what is time averaging. I explained to you what is ensemble averaging, what you need for ensemble in time-independent systems. I introduced the concept of ensemble, which are mental replicas. One state, trillions of mental replicas, all in the same macroscopic state, same number of particles, volume and energy, and everything else is the same. But they inhabit different microscopic state. And then I first postulate is ensemble average equal to time average. But then I needed to do the distribution. In order to do the averaging, I needed distribution. And on the, in that, that is, second postulate is on ensemble, that I have equilibrium problem. All the microscopic states I am putting my system in, my mental are in same problem. That's called equally priority problem. A priority means before knowing anything. There's nothing else wrong.
So I have a question.
Yes.
So do you consider the molecular interaction when you do a probability distribution?
Sure. Everything is there.
If that happened, suppose I am considering a box full of gases. So at the surface of the world, there is less probability to go there because there is an inward pull at the
yes, side. Inwards. But you know, that is already taken into account because you do molecule surface interaction. So there is another interaction potential that comes in, which takes into surface interactions. And so the trajectory of the system that is evolving has that information within it. And then averages are being done on the properties of the system, like pressure and other things. Already has that. So you can see many papers write down, there is liquid near a wall. And you will see that near a liquid wall, then you will find there is a kind of a drying transition. So all these things are okay. There are no problem.
So if we can do an experiment for an infinite time, then the time average and maximum average will be the same.
Yes, that has been proven many, many times now by computer simulation. This is proven. What I'm saying, everything is proven. At the 1960s or 70s, not too long ago, it was well, because of any analytical work, it's short. But now the computer simulation, when you do molecular dynamic simulation, that is time trajectory. When you do Monte Carlo simulations, that is ensemble. Those two give the same.
So I have another question. So when we do a probability distribution, why don't we take relativity into account?
Relativistic statistical mechanics is very different, and the relativity becomes important. Just like Schrodinger ignored relativistic effect, because it's only when the velocity of the particles are close to that of the light, v by theta, we are far, far lower than that.
But we take 0 to infinite when we do a probability distribution. So
yeah, but probability distribution goes to 0 long way. We do that minus v square. So it goes long before that. Long before that. V goes to 0 by the time you have 5, maybe 10 kBT by m. That is a 1 trillion, probably not 1 trillion, must be 1 billion of the light, speed of light. Okay? Okie dokie. Now you will get your rewards. And if I want to put anything, I know how to get it to get to you guys. All right, ladies and gentlemen, see you on Thursday.